Hello viewers, this is Janisar Ahmed from Bronx, New York. I'm presenting you on behalf of Millennium TV USA. I welcome you to my program, News and Views. Today I would be talking about US elections, not only US elections, but how President Obama dealt with his 8-year term in office. We would have to go back to the time when he was campaigning for office. That was, of course, a time of tremendous expectations. The people had lots of expectations, and he was seen as an agent of change. And his motto, I remember, his motto was, change we can believe in. And there were President Obama was the first black going to be the first black president, and so we could see the blacks in the U.S. they were happy for their they had their reason to go out and vote, and secondly the message that he was projecting. It seemed like it was a very all-inclusive kind of his message, and his whole campaign was very much, it was like bordering on diversity, and like he had unity in polarity. So President Obama, we could tell, and I could tell at that time that he was going to be the president, and we saw that he won the office, he won the elections and took office amidst tremendous expectations, and the people were very happy. It was a time of a real change, because as you know, the material world that we live in, it is based on ideas. When you think and when you form an idea, it is only that after you formulate an idea that you can materialize that idea into a practical thing or shape. So President Obama's idea was to in fact bring change in America, in the mindset of the American people, and to a very large extent with the voter turnout that he got, and the love and respect that he got from different segments of the people, we could tell that he was going to be one of the you know, greatest presidents in the US history ever. And but at the time when he took office, he realized that he was up against lots of challenges. It was not as easy as he thought or seemed at the start. And slowly he had to cope with the reality. He had to inherit a crumbling economy. We must remember that it was President George Bush's 8 years in office, and America had been at wars, and America had to dealt with foreign threats, and so a lot of resources and finances they had to be diverted into that effort, and it was not that easy because when you are at war, you have to make some sacrifice. So naturally, American economy, it was in a kind of it was in a shambles. We know that. So one of his biggest challenges was to fix the economy, and how he would do that, because if you could not enable an ordinary man to make ends meet, then that means your promise of change and hope, and that has not materialized. So first of all, it goes to his credit that he installed a team of economic experts, and they sat down to fixing the economy. And he did that in a very wonderful way. He The Congress passed, as I think it was, $737 billion economic stimulus package, and he signed that bill. So, and with that money, he also signed an economic package to the tune of, I think, close to $70 billion, and that was pumped into the auto industry, because the, as you know, the General Motors and the Chrysler industries, they had broken down. So all that money had to be given to those industries, and naturally we could see that people were getting jobs, and slowly the American public, it was on its way to recovery. The economy was recuperating. It was coming back into shape. And at that time, he had to face a lot of criticism from the Republicans, because they were not willing. They were of the view that this package, economic package, might go to waste. It might not help enable Obama into what he was planning to do. So, but he succeeded in giving that package. And secondly, we could see that the low-income households, they were also able to stage a recovery. They were having more jobs, and overall, the American economy, It had lots of, like if you compare it with the other economies of the world, say the UK or India for that matter. First of all, there is no comparison between an Asian and a US economy, of course. But at that time, things were really not looking up. So Obama, it goes to, I would again say, it goes to President Obama's credit that he enabled the American economy to recover. And some people are of the view that President George Bush, during his last months in office, his team was able to give a sort of bailout package to certain banks, and so that a total collapse of the economy was prevented, and which enabled President Obama to carry on that effort. But overall, what he did, it was no ordinary feat. He was successful because he had put in a tremendous team, and he was able to achieve that and achieve a lot for the American public and voters. So if you can say that there was some kind of change, yes, there was some kind of change. It was good for the average man. It was good for the economy. And we could see the manufacturing jobs were starting to pop up. And I would give President Obama definitely credit for that, because if you could see things moving, then that definitely means that things are moving in a positive way. And so you have to give him like 10 out of 10. Ladies and gentlemen, now we move on to our next subject, which is the Affordable Care Act, also known as the Obamacare. It was the subject of intense debate, especially between the Republicans and the Democrats. Obviously, because there has been no other bill or act that has been subject to so much debate and controversy. I personally haven't seen any subject that was shuttled back and forth. And you can tell if the Republicans are not happy, why they are not happy, and why the Democrats, President Obama, he definitely might have his own reason to present this bill and have it enacted. Having a look at the lives of the people and the tremendous cost which you have to bear when you are going to a doctor or going to have medical insurance. This act seems like a blessing to me, given the fact that there have been some people that I have talked to, and they never had previously any access to healthcare. They were able to go and see a doctor only because of Obamacare, and they were happy that they had that they could now take care of themselves, and that they now had access to medicine, to a doctor, and to a hospital. But at the end of the day, there is virtually you cannot pass any judgment on Affordable Care Act, because at the State of the Union address, when President Obama was talking in favor of the Affordable Care Act, you could see a Republican leader Paul Ryan, he was not happy, and he was shaking his shoulders, and you know that I am not happy, and I do not agree with you, but with whatever you are saying. So it was like a kind of a hot potato, and you cannot form any opinion on it. But of course, if you ask me, I would say, given my limited knowledge, that it has brought about some positive change in the lives of the people. There was this research conducted in Chicago, which referred about close to 40,000 people who registered right after the Affordable Care Act was enacted, and they had the opportunity to go and register and live a normal, healthy life. And previously, they were all by themselves, and they were unable to go and take care of themselves, and whatever was happening to their bodies, and nobody was, they could not help themselves. So those facts, those figures show that it did have a positive impact. And there are other figures and research data that shows that after the Affordable Care Act, people were able to, more and more people were able to sign up, and they were able to find treatment for very fatal kind of diseases. And so that was one aspect of Affordable Care Act. I remember talking to a doctor. He was not happy, and he said, well, I don't know, it's not a very good act. But I talked to another doctor, and he was all for it. So again, as I've said earlier, it was a hot potato, and it still is. And as you cannot pass any judgment, but the impact that it made, for instance, the health debt. Health debt, viewers, is a very serious thing, or a liability. Health debt means that in order to pay for your health insurance, you accrue a lot of expenses, and which leaves a very negative impact on your pocket. And so the amount of saving that you could have done, you are unable to do because of that health debt. And it also leaves a psychological impact. So because of the Affordable Care Act, some research data shows that debt was reduced. Overall, it had been reduced. So again, it left a very, very positive impact. And what's the future of Obamacare? I do not know. You, the viewers, are the best judge, but it would be taken up by the next administration. New York Times, in one of its reports, it conducted a research, and talking about the positive impacts of Affordable Care Act, it referred to certain minority groups and Hispanics, and that a great number of Hispanics who were like documented and living here as legal residents, they were able to take advantage of the Affordable Care Act. And previously, they had no access to health care. So definitely coming from a person of President Obama's stature and wisdom, I would give him 10 out of 10 for the Affordable Care Act, because from a strong economy like the U.S., if you are able to take something out for the general public, I think you are doing the public a great favor. And so on that count, viewers, let's have a look at a video that shows how President Obama's Affordable Care Act made its impact on the general public. Viewers, now we move on to our next segment, which is how President Obama dealt with foreign nations, what his foreign policy was. That was, of course, one of the biggest challenges that he inherited, and he had to deal with a number of forces that were very complicated to deal with in the first place. President Obama's approach was marked by a degree of pragmatism and I would say patience, and a sort of, it was an all-inclusive kind of foreign policy. Some people would say that President Bush's years were years of unilateralism, and in those times, some of the foreign nations were not very happy with how they were dealt with. But they, of course, there were reasons for those times, and they were, America was at war, and it was not an easy period, and it was a tough time for everybody. But how, since President Obama had made this promise to bring about a change, and people were banking on that promise. One was that he would see the Iraq and Afghanistan wars to an end, and also he would like usher in a new chapter of relations with the outer world. How President Obama was able to do that, it's very easy, but it's very hard to do it practically. But he had the stamina to do it, and he had the personality to do it. That's of course my opinion, but we would start from Iraq and Afghanistan. The countries were in a mess, and President Obama did a very good thing, that he followed up on his promise to withdraw the U.S. forces, and he did that, and he made it clear to everybody that the U.S. was going to pull out its troops, not all together in one go, but gradually, so that all the territory that has been, all the gains that had been made, the U.S. is able to bank on those gains, substantiate on those gains, and then they would pull out the troops. He was successful in doing that. When the troops, he ordered the troops to come back, there was a degree of success in Afghanistan. The militants, they had been contained. The terror networks, they had been destroyed, and same was happening in Iraq. Of course, President Obama was very cautious in how he would do that, because that was not an easy job on part of the president to do it. He had pressure from different like countries, and at the same time there was a drone warfare going on in Pakistan, in Yemen, and some people would like compare President Obama with President Bush as to how both of them were able to perform on the terror front. And believe it or not, President Obama did a good job than President Bush, because he was able to specifically focus on the militant leadership and their you know, terror cells that were operating in isolated kind of different areas of South Asia, including in parts of Pakistan. And despite the leadership from Pakistan that was not happy, he was able to carry out all those drone attacks. And for instance, it was during his time that one of the biggest leaders of Taliban, Baitullah Masood, he was killed in a drone attack, and it goes to his credit. And also, one day, all the Americans got the good news that the biggest terrorist, Osama bin Laden, he had been killed by in an attack by U.S. Special Forces, and that was a very, very big achievement. And it turned out that he was living quite close to a military establishment academy of Pakistan near Abbottabad. So how President Obama dealt with all those forces, he had the like the upper hand, and he was able to conduct himself and make it very clear to the world leaders that America was not going to back down, and America was the U.S. was going to continue with the previous administration's policies, because the U.S. homeland, it had to be secured, and it had to be secured from the threats emerging from different dangerous corners of the world. So President Obama was applauded by the U.S. public, and we could see that as a result of you know, zeroing in on those militant networks, the U.S. public, they were happy with him, and he got a second chance to come to office and serve the public once again. So on that front, President Obama made tremendous achievements. And not only that, actually, it didn't make the world leaders angry, because in a way, what he was doing, what the U.S. was doing during his leadership was, it was also doing a favor to those countries. For instance, in Pakistan, when Osama was killed and when Baitullah Masood was killed, the Pakistani public had been actually Baitullah Masood, they were carrying out attacks in Pakistan against Pakistani public. So the U.S. did a favor to the Pakistani public and government. And so he earned a respect, you know, all over the world, in Afghanistan, in Pakistan, for his very, you know, like straightforward kind of foreign policy. And also, you could see the one very big challenge emerging right next to Pakistan and Afghanistan in Iran. The Iranian nation is known for its stringent views, and they are they are known as very like slim customers when it comes to negotiations. And and how they negotiated with the U.S., we could tell that it was not easy for the Obama administration to negotiate, because they were proving to be tough customers, slim customers, and they were taking their time more than the time that had been allotted to them. And the issue was President Obama was able to tell the Iranians that they cannot build a bomb for the sake of building a bomb, and they had to stop all the nuclear reactors that were used that could have been used to make a nuclear device. President Obama was successful in preventing Iran from building a nuclear device, and that is in fact counted as among his biggest achievements. Iran backed off, and it realized that there was no need to enter into a nuclear arms race because it was pointless, and all of that energy could be used towards helping its economy and in other constructive ways. It goes to President Obama's credit, his leadership skills, and the way he reached out a hand of friendship to the Iranian leadership at that time, that they realized this, that here was a friend in the White House, and he could be counted on, and that whatever he was telling was true, and he was trustworthy. So you could see that it was President Obama's personality that was able to achieve that. Now, there is definitely some controversy because there is a viewpoint that says that the president gave too much away to Iran, and it had the breakout time, the time that Iran could use to build a bomb, and etc. But that breakout time that had also that has been reduced, and now it has been limited to a couple of months. So overall, the Iran deal it was successful, and President Obama, his administration was able to prevent a confrontation with Iran. Of course, Iran is not that militarily strong to engage with a power like the U.S. Of course, but still, it could create a mess in the region, and it did when it kidnapped around, I think, 16 U.S. Marines. So Iran was hostile, and there was a kind of hostility amongst the Iranian leadership. Whatever their policy had been since the Iranian Revolution, and they were definitely not happy with the U.S. But there was a marked change in the Iranian viewpoint towards the U.S. And slowly we could see when the Iranian Prime Minister came over to the U.S. at the UN session, he was in a very like a friendly mood, and he tweeted a very friendly message towards the U.S. administration, President Obama. So we could see that there was President Obama. He prevented a confrontation, and instead of making a needless enemy, he was able to make a new friend in Iran. And all that energy that could have been wasted, and all those resources that could have been wasted, he was able to turn that around into channel that into a positive and constructive way. And so now you could see Iran is pumping finances into the U.S. I think air industry. It's buying certain jets from one of the U.S. companies, and the deals are the sanctions have been lifted to a certain extent, and Iran is also looks happy, and the days of Ahmadinejad, who was making he was engaging in saber rattling against the U.S. Day in, day out, those days are over. And again, you would say that it's because of President Obama that he showed the tremendous leadership quality and change the entire outlook of the Iranian regime. So that goes to his credit. And this tone and tenor of the president was also reflected in dealing with the other nations of the world, not only the Muslim world, but you could see it reflected in how he reached out to the Cuban leadership. I think if my memory serves me right, it was in 54 years or maybe 58 years that the U.S. was able to open an embassy in Havana, and the Cuban government was likewise able to extend a hand of friendship towards the U.S. The relations had not been very good because of the revolution in Cuba, and Fidel Castro had been in power. You know, from going back to the early days of revolution, it was a tumultuous period, and the Cubans they are an educated nation. The literacy rate is very good, is very high, and there is absolutely no need to be you know, at loggerhead. And so that character of the president, it was appreciated within the Cuban territory, and you could see that there was no point in being you know, an enemy and making needless hostile statements against one another, as previously had been made by the Cuban leadership. So now there was a change, and now the Cuba is a different country towards America, and so is America towards Cuba. The relations have improved. The embassies have opened up in both the nations, and people look forward to visiting each other's nations. And so that's how you can see that President Obama has made a very tangible change in his foreign policy, because that's how his whole personality is. That's how that's who President Obama is. He is like in his personal life, he is a very humble human being, and he's a good father and good listener, and all of those qualities he took on to the world stage and showed it to the world leaders, that I am there to work with you, and I'm not out there to harm you in any way. So viewers, President Obama's years in office, to a very large extent, they would be seen as years of stability and the years of unilateralism over. And the people all over the world, they were starting to look towards Obama as a world leader, as a mature leader who could be counted upon. So overall, it was a successful period. Now let's have a look at the video showing Obama's years and his dealings with the world leaders. Viewers, now we move on to our last segment, and we would focus on Obama's concluding term last few months office, and how he was able to navigate through a lot of problems that propped up. President Obama continued with his tradition of bringing about a change, the change that he had promised, and he wanted to live up to his the people's expectations, and naturally he wanted to see a more democratic society. A society in which people of all races, colors, and hues, and different orientations had the freedom to live the kind of life that they want to live. And so you could see in following up the promise, he enacted the presented the gay acts the LGBT bill, and it was enacted into a law, and it was a huge like a win-win for the LGBT community, and they were able to live a life of dignity, and it did away with the don't ask and don't tell rule in the US military. And so the members of the community, LGBT community, they could serve in the armed forces and live a life that they had been wanting to live for a very long time, and the rights that they had been denied to them. And Democrats were, it was like in sync with their philosophy. Previously, some of the Democratic leaders, they had been you know, talking about the LGBT community, and they were like giving vibes that they would, if elected to power, they would you know, give them equal rights as citizens. And it happened during Obama's term. Now, some viewers, some say, analysts would say that this was too early for the American society, and that you know, the it shouldn't have happened, but coming from President Obama's wisdom and what he thought was best, you could see that it enabled the members of the community to have the freedom that they wanted. And so there was a lot of discrimination that was that the LGBT members were subjected to, and naturally it came to an end, and more people they were having the thought that they now could live with more freedom, that they would have the respect that they deserve when they would go out and interact with the public. So that is counted amongst President Obama's very you know, big successes. And because he did not want to limit himself to one particular community. He was a president of the American public, and he was all ears to people from all different segments of the society, and he lived up to his promise, and that would be seen as a very progressive and a very pragmatic decision in the years to come. And secondly, president believed that the greenhouse gases and the global warming was doing a lot of damage to the planet because of all the industrial activity, and that the greenhouses are contributing to damaging the atmosphere and the environment. And he wanted to do something in order to control that, because of all the hurricanes and this increased atmospheric activity that has been disturbing the environment and the regular, you know, flow of the planet. President Obama was very careful in how he would deal with those with this problem, and so you know, his stance on climate change was very categorical, that it was it had to be stopped, and that global warming was a very real, tangible kind of evil that was preventing human beings from you know, living a healthy life, and it was in the days to come, it was going to be destructive for the planet, because it was leading to the glaciers were melting, more and more glaciers are melting. The speed with which the melting is taking place, that has increased all the greenhouse gases, they are also, apart from making a hole in the ozone layer, it is causing hurricanes and cyclones in the US. And all whatever president has been saying regarding the climate change, that has been backed up by various researchers and scientists. So the president was able to convince the public that they needed to be very careful about this evil, and that a certain amount of funding it had to be allocated towards dealing with this problem. And he was also, he went on a on a show with a reality TV star, and why he went and into the wild was just to show his appreciation for the Mother Earth and then the forests that, that are being depleted and that they need to be protected. So in that show, you could have a glimpse at the real Obama and what kind of human being, human he was. He wanted to protect the forest, the rivers, the seas, and the environment. So it would be seen as one of his achievements, I would say, to be able to protect the environment, not only for this generation, but for the future generations to come. And President Obama's last days, these are his, of course, he is going to hand over power, and the new president is going to take office. And this last year has been very momentous kind of year for the president. In the last days, the office itself is referred to as a lame duck office. The president is known as a lame duck because he has power to enact laws and make decisions that are limited because of certain constitutional reasons. However, in this time of transition and change, president has been able to conduct himself in a very gentleman-like kind of way. He has dealt with whatever he had been saying during the election campaign, because he was supporting Hillary Clinton. He toned down on that, and he appreciated and welcomed the president-elect Donald J. Trump to the White House, and reassured him that he was there to support him, and the transition was going to be very smooth, and he respected the new president. And so all of the hostility, perhaps not the hostility, but the kind of the saber-rattling that was seen during the election days, it came to an end, and the president was able to confirm to the public that it was a sportsman spirit that was in play during those last days in office, and because this was a time when you could see that the general vote, the popular vote, Hillary Clinton was able to garner, was able to win that popular vote, and of course, President-elect Donald Trump, he won the majority of the Electoral College vote, and definitely that is what the Constitution says as to who is going to be the president. So during all this period, the same kind of personality, the same kind of the tone and tenor, the gentleman Obama that we have been seeing during the 8 years, he was able to build on that, to continue that tradition with with the new coming administration, and conduct himself in a very in a very welcoming manner. So overall, there was no display of hostility, of anger, like that, as if he was not happy with the election. So he displayed sportsman spirit. That is what his whole 8 years in office tell us. They are a witness to how he succeeded in office and did so much for the country. Definitely the people, the American public, they would miss his years in office. And speaking of that, the president also gave a certain sense of hope to the blacks. Naturally, America has a history of racial disturbance going back to the Civil War and even beyond. But the very fact that President Obama was able to exude the confidence that he was there to represent all the people, and he could display the leadership skills, and he could show that he was there to lead and make America what it should have been. So it gave all the people, all the minorities, a sense of respect, because as I've said earlier, the idea, any idea, it has to be materialized, and whatever is in concrete shape is materialized, comes from an idea. So President Obama's idea of bringing about change, to a certain extent, he was successful. Now we could see the people, they definitely how they view their outlook at life in general, in the American, how they view the American way of life. It definitely has changed, and President Obama has a role in that change, and definitely in the years to come, American society and public definitely would be built on that change that President Obama brought. Thank you viewers very much for watching, and stay tuned. This is Janis Ahmed from Bronx doing this show for Millennium TV USA, and see you until the next show.